Okay, please open your Bibles to the book of Matthew, Mark, second book of the New Testament, chapter 1, and it's the end of chapter 1, verses 40 through 45. It's there in your bulletin, but I encourage you to have your own Bible, and as you're turning there, just a quick note, if you're trying to get there in your mobile app, it's the version that probably is not included in your app. We're going to use the 1984 New International Version, and most of the apps will only allow for the 2011, and that is key for today, and I'll explain while we're in the message. But if you're on a mobile device, then maybe you can Google NIV 1984 PDF or NIV 1984 download on your mobile device, and that will lead you to some links to some sites that will get you to the 1984. Otherwise, you'll have difficulty finding it. So there's a keyword in there that we'll need, that the 2011 doesn't have. Okay, so we're in Mark chapter 1. And we're at the very end, so let's read together verse 40 through 45. Mark chapter 1, verses 40 through 45. Please read it with me. A man with leprosy came to him and begged him on his knees, "If you are willing, you can make me clean." Filled with compassion, Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. "I am willing," he said, "be clean." Immediately the leprosy left him and he was cured. Jesus sent him away at once with a strong warning. "See that you don't tell this to anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest and offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them." Instead, he went out and began to talk freely, spreading the news. As a result, Jesus could no longer enter a town openly, but stayed outside in lonely places. Yet the people still came to him from everywhere. The very words of God. Amen. Well, our subject today is kingdom cleansing. I want to ask you, have you checked your weather report? What's the weather going to be? I thought it was going to be rainy, because it said rainy today. And then when Naomi and I woke up, we opened the curtains and the glory of the sun was shining brightly. And then the clouds came later on. So unfortunately, yesterday, my school had the opening ceremony. We welcomed the new students into our school. And usually, the mothers are in kimono, the fathers have their suit on, and they take a picture under the cherry blossoms around our school, but it was raining, so they couldn't do that. But when it rains like this, I always look forward to the next day when it's going to be sunny and beautiful. I'm from California, Southern California, also known as the land of sun and smog. And it's beautiful when it's sunset because the smog makes everything beautiful, like orange and purple and all the beautiful hues. You can't get that with clear skies. But then sometimes it rains. And when it rains hard, the next day all the smog and filth and gunk get washed away by the rain and the wind, and you can see so far. And the same is true here as well. This morning when we opened the curtains, the sky was a brilliant blue. And oftentimes from my window at my school, you can see all the way to my wife's hometown, Kure. It's so clear, it's so beautiful, because the rain has cleansed the sky. And so our subject for today's sermon is the kingdom cleansing. We're in the kingdom of God this year, and we're seeing how Jesus cleansed a leper. And we don't use the word healed when we talk about the word leprosy, because God has a special word just for healing the disease of leprosy, and that's called cleansing. And why does he do that? Well, let's get into it. So, it says that a man with leprosy came to him and begged him on his knees. This story is actually in three of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. All three of them tell this same story about this man who had this disease of leprosy. Are you familiar with this disease? Do you know about it? In my school, we have some charities that we're involved with. One of them is with a leper hospice. Leprosy hospice? There's a facility in Okayama. It's called Aiseien. And Japan, a long time ago, had cases of leprosy that was predominant. And whenever a person had in Japan came down with leprosy, they were sent away to various facilities, sanitariums, I guess you could say, throughout the country. And one of them was located in Okayama. So our students, every one of them, at least once, one of the years that they're attending our school, have to go out and visit this leper, not a leper colony, because it's no longer people stricken with leprosy and they have to live there. They live there by choice. But let's see, the numbers now worldwide, I guess there are about just under 1 million cases of leprosy in the world today. I visited the one out in Okayama. Also, when I went to the Philippines a few years ago, we were allowed to visit one of the facilities that we help sponsor, which is also a leper hospice, leprosy hospice. And so what we find out is leprosy is a disease caused by a bacteria called bacilli. This was discovered by a man named Hansen in 1873. And that's why in Japan, the word for leprosy is called Hansenbyō. Byō meaning disease. And Hansen is named after Hansen, so Hansen's disease. Now, so Hansenbyō is what we find here. A man ravaged by the disease of this bacteria that starts by eating away at the nerves. And what happens is you can see that on the face there's some pink or white kind of spots. And at first it's kind of dry. And then maybe the hair around there starts falling away. And then later on it develops and it becomes kind of pussy and moldy. And then after that it begins to get flaky and scaly. And you can just kind of, you know, falls off. The skin just kind of falls off. And from there it starts spreading really all over your skin. And it gets into your internal organs. And the word leprosy actually comes from the word, Greek word leper, which means scaly. And also in Hebrew, the word is also scales. So it just kind of describes your skin, scaly. But it's a description of what's happening all throughout your body, which is the disease is just eating away your nerves and you can't feel anything. And for most of you, you know, when you hit something, you feel pain, and that tells you not to hit again. But in leprosy, if you hit it, you don't feel pain, and so you got no problem. And so there are lots of stories of lepers reaching into the fire to pick up a piece of food or something, and they burn off their hand, but they don't realize it. Or a leper will go to sleep, and maybe a rat will come and eat one of his fingers. He wakes up, his finger's gone. because he never felt the rat eating his finger. So in biblical times, if you had this disease, you had to live away from all of the people. So what was called living outside of the camp. And it was complete isolation. If you had a family, you could no longer live with your family. If you had friends, no more contact with friends. And it was so bad that the only time you could see them or meet them or have contact was you had to pick a third location. And so you lived in your place with other lepers, and your family lived in the city. And maybe your family, if they still cared for you, they would take their food or your food or some clothes and they would put it in one place. They would leave and then you could go and pick up the supplies or the things, the love, the care package. That was your only contact with the people you loved. Are you feeling this, man? Can you understand the isolation, the desolation, and the desperation that this man felt? And Luke, when he tells this story, he says this man was full of leprosy. It means it had completely overtaken him. When you had leprosy to that degree, you had to cover your face. And the Bible said you had to tear your clothes. And so you had to show that you were leprous. And so you ripped up your clothing so that when people looked, you had torn clothing. It was dirty. They knew you were a leper, and just in case they didn't know, you had to shout, "Unclean! Unclean! Unclean!" so that people would know for sure you were a leper. You were not to have contact. You were not to have conversation. And it got so bad that sometimes the bacteria would get into your throat. It would start eating your vocal cords. And you could actually listen to your disease eating at you, and you'd have a voice that was raspy, and you couldn't even speak normal. That's how bad it was. And so here's this man. He's full of leprosy. He's lived maybe decades in this condition. He was full of leprosy. It wasn't a few years. It was a long, long time. If he was married when he got leprosy, he hadn't seen his wife for so long. If he had children when he had contracted leprosy, he hadn't seen or touched his children for so long. In fact, he wasn't even allowed to see his friends, his family, nothing. And in fact, if he tried to make contact, there are records of people who, just in case they should happen to see a leper, they carried rocks in their pocket so that they could throw it at the leper to keep him away. And so this man, he's so desperate. He's so just tired of being alone. He goes to Jesus. It says he comes to Jesus. Do you understand how much of a risk, how much peril he has put himself in to get to Jesus? Jesus is in the middle of a crowd. He's in a town. And this man is not supposed to be in a town or near a crowd. And somehow, I can just see it. Jesus is there in the middle of a crowd. And he starts coming, and people just look and see his clothes. Maybe they hear him shouting, "Unclean, unclean." And then it just open up a way. Give him a wide berth. And he gets it. Maybe some of them are throwing things at him. Maybe some of them are shouting, "Get out of here! What are you doing?" People are hiding their children. People are shouting and screaming out of disgust and loathe for this man. But he gets to Jesus. He gets there. Sometimes you just don't care anymore. You're not ashamed. You don't care what other people say. You're not worried about your reputation. You're not worried about what might happen to you. You know you are sick. You need a cure. You know something's wrong, and there was one person who can make it right, and it doesn't matter what everybody else says. That's where this man is at. And then it says he comes and he begged Jesus on his knees. So this man comes, he falls to his knees. The disease is eating away at his body. Who knows? Was it easy for him to get down on his knees? And the other writers say he got down on his face. I don't know. But oh, the pain he must have been in. And he says, Lord, if you are willing, you can heal me? No. If you are willing, you can make me clean. He says, Jesus, I've heard about you. People have been talking about you for so long now. I didn't know if you're going to come, but you're here. And I heard that you command demons to come out of people. And Lord, I've heard that when people are sick, you heal them. It says that you healed everybody. And Lord, I up to this point, who knows if he had healed any lepers? We don't know. Maybe he has. I'm sure he's healed a lot of lepers, but we're not sure. This could be the first leper. And so it's possible he could say, Lord, I don't know if you heal leprosy. But if there is anybody who can fix me, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Whoo! Those are some beautiful words. So beautiful that Luke, Matthew, Mark, and Luke record them. All three. God wants us to hear this man's words. God wants us to feel this man's faith. And God wants us to repeat this prayer to him. Lord, if you are willing. Because there's nothing in me. I have no right. Many of you think, because I'm a decent person, I'm a human being, I have a right. Kendigar. I'm entitled to blessing. Bless me. Because there's something good in me that you should see, God. But this leper says, no, there's nothing good in me. I'm completely dirty. But Lord, if you are willing, that's faith. That's beautiful faith. And so, next word, verse 41. Filled with compassion. Filled with compassion. This is Pastor Hiroshi's point when he preached this morning. The scripture says, Yesu ga fukaku awarenda. Fukaku awarenda. Te o sashi nobeta. Fukaku awarenda. Deep mercy. Right? Fukaku awarenda. Deep compassion. That is a word I want you to circle, I want you to take note of. The word compassion there, that's the word that the NIV 2000 translates differently. It's an important word. It's the Greek is, I can't pronounce it, splagnon. Splagnon. Jesus, splagnon. And if you can hear it, you can probably feel it. It literally means intestines, stomach, liver. What is that word? Gazo? Nizo? Something like that? Guts. Jesus felt it here. Right here. That's the word. Compassion. And we believe the best way to translate it is compassion, because if you read the other ways that the Bible uses that word, it's compassion. To have a heart that goes out. To feel pity. This is an amazing word, because this is Jesus, God, the creator of heaven and earth, was moved in his guts. Can you believe that? This is God, who is holy, righteous, has no sin. And what is it that almost makes him lose control? Is it the sound of a beautiful song? Is it the earnest prayer? Is it the command? No, it's the begging of a man who's desperate. He was full of leprosy, and he begged Jesus. This is... because I talked to some students, and I asked them, what do you think about God? Oh, yeah, he's there. Who is he? Well, he's love, but maybe he's far away. He's holy. He doesn't come close to people because he's holy. But Jesus, splagnon. He felt compassion. He came near. I have three sons. Maybe you can hear them right now. And what moves me to help them, you know, this morning they get up at 6:30. It's Sunday morning. It's 6:30. Dad. I don't want to move. Dad, I want to play. No. Dad loves to watch TV. Kamen Rider. No. Dad, I'm hungry. No. Nothing. But let one of them fall and let me hear a thump, a dong, and then after that, a cry of desperation, of pain and agony. I'm up. I'm up. I'm moving. My eyes are open. I'm alert. Splagnon. I'm ready. What do you need? If you need to pick you up, fine. Whatever you need. Jesus is God. And what does he say in the Psalms 37 verse 4? He is near the brokenhearted, and with those who are crushed in spirit, God had compassion. What is it that God wants out of you? The sacrifices of God, Psalm 51, are a broken and contrite heart. Yes, come with songs. Yes, thank him. Yes, sing. Yes, give. Yes, serve. Oh, but if you want God to move, come with your broken heart. Come, and he will move. It says it right there in the book. So Jesus has compassion. And so what does he do? He says, I'm willing. This is so cool. He uses the man's words right back to him. Can you see what he did? The man says, if you're willing, you can make me clean. And Jesus, just like a mirror, says, yeah, I'm willing. Took the words right out of my mouth. I'm willing because I have compassion. So be clean. Thank you, Jesus. Reaches out and touches him. I could get into that, but you know that just to be touched. The man hasn't been touched in how long? And Jesus touches him? Leviticus chapter 5 says, you don't touch. And Jesus said, no, I'm God. I touch. I touch him, and he's clean. Verse 42, immediately the leprosy left him, and he was cured. So he was healed. Now, let's see, what's the name? Paul Brand, Dr. Paul Brand, 1983, came out with not a cure, but a treatment that pretty much has not wiped out, but is almost wiping out leprosy in our modern time. Dr. Paul Brand, great doctor. He found something that if you see a case of leprosy, it will now hinder the bacteria from spreading and growing. And people are not being cured because what this medicine does is it stops the spread. But if you've lost something, if you have, you know, if you were debilitated or if the disease has eaten something, the medicine doesn't bring back the finger. It doesn't give you a new liver. But it stops it from getting worse. But here, Jesus says, he was cured. This is God touching a man. And whatever he had lost, it's back, people. The hair that was gone, it's there again. The voice that was messed up, it can sing again. He was cured, okay? This is Jesus touching a man. Now, what's the next step after he's cleansed? This is important. This is how, what we go home on. This is what gives me the fire in my belly. Okay? What is it that Jesus wants us to do? Jesus wants us to go to the Old Testament. 43. Jesus sent him away and at once gave him a strong warning. Strong warning. Jesus grunted at him. It's like me when I'm playing basketball to my basketball. That's how it is. That's the word. He grunted at him and said, "See that you don't tell this to anyone." So that's the negative. And then the positive. "But go, show yourself to the priest and offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them." What's going on here? Have you ever read that and said, "Why? Why, Jesus?" Because most of the preachers, they tell you, "Go out and tell the world. Shout it from the mountaintop. Shout, Jesus is Lord. He's risen. Da, 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 da. Go." And Jesus says, "Don't go. Do not go. Don't go telling everybody whatever." He says, instead, go to the temple and get a certificate? What? Why? Why? Because Jesus wants to take you to a very special place. Jesus wants to show you this is not just about a new hand. This is not just about coming back to my friends. This is about the kingdom of God, eternal life. This is not about healing. This is about cleansing. So where do we go? We go to Leviticus chapter 14. What? Leviticus chapter 14. What? I haven't read that book in years. Yes, read it again. Leviticus chapter 14. I said a few weeks ago, I was talking to somebody. I said, "You need to get into Leviticus. Because in Leviticus is the gospel." So what does he say? Leviticus chapter 14. I'll give you the summary. If you had leprosy, a skin disease, you go to the priest. And the priest was like Jesus, the mediator between God and man. He was to pray for you and to help you with your relationship with God. And how did he do that? You come with an offering. If you had leprosy, you came with two birds. Okay? And one bird, you combine it with some wood and some hyssop, and you put it over some running water, fresh water. And that water is a symbol of God who makes you clean. And what you do is you kill that bird and you shed its blood. Why? Because what you did was you put your sins on that bird. And the life of that bird was a substitute for your life. So the blood of that bird paid for your life. Does that sound familiar? And then you take that bird and you're going to burn it. But you take another bird, that second bird. And you take that second bird, you put your sins on that bird. You pray over that bird and you confess your sins over it. You dip that bird in the blood which washes your sins. And then you let it go free. What does that mean? It's a symbol of God taking your sins and letting it get out of the way. Taking your sins away. So in that ceremony, God is showing you not just your body, but your heart. Your life is being paid for by blood, and your sin is being taken away by God. Does that sound familiar? Does it sound familiar? Jesus is telling you, go to the priests and do this. But then here's what else happens. You go to the priest, you take those birds, one is pays for your sins, one takes away the sins, and then you take a bath. When's the last time you took a bath when you had leprosy? Because it shows that you're washing yourself clean. And then you shave your body. You shave all of your hair, including your eyebrows, to show what? It shows that you're like a newborn baby. You're being born again. Does that sound familiar?
And after you've been born again, you put on some new clothes. And you go back inside the camp. You go back to your friends. You go back to your family. You go back to your wife and your children. And you can touch again. You can eat together. You can party again. You can catch up. For a week. And then after a week, you go back. You get two lambs. And you do to the lambs the same thing you did with the birds. You prayed over one, and that was a substitute for your sins. You prayed over the other, and you let it go. Oh, no, excuse me. That was a burnt offering. Excuse me. It's like the Yom Kippur. But anyways. And then after that, you shave again, and you wash again. And here's the beautiful thing. You're completely washed. You're completely whole. You're completely made new. And then here's what the priest does. He takes the blood from the lamb. He puts a little bit on your ear. And he takes a little bit on your thumb. And he puts a little bit on your toes, on your toe. What is that? And then he takes some oil. And he puts a little bit of the oil, he puts it on top of the blood that was on your ear. Puts a little bit more oil on your thumb and a little bit more oil on your toe. What is that? The blood. The blood from the Lamb. Who is the Lamb? Jesus Christ. The Lamb who takes away the sins of the world. 1 Peter chapter 1. Jesus Christ, the spotless Lamb. You're His now. You've been cleansed. You belong to Him. So with your ears, you listen to His words. With your hands, you serve Him. And with your feet, you walk in His ways. Right? It's Jesus. Right there in Leviticus. With His blood. But within with the oil. What's the oil? It's the Holy Spirit. The anointing of the Holy Spirit. That's what anointed means. Jesus, the Christ, the anointed one. Anointed of the Holy Spirit. And so you listen, you work, and you walk with the blood of Jesus washing you clean, but also in the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the oil. That's your new life. Now that you've been cleansed, you're in the kingdom of God, you take in the Word of God. You serve Jesus with your hands and you walk in His ways. That's what Jesus wants us to do. So He tells this leper, go. Why? To show as a testimony to who? To them. It says right there. Do it as a testimony to them. To who? The priests. You see, Jesus didn't want that man just to tell anybody else. He wanted that man to tell very important people. The priests. Why? Because Ezekiel, the prophet, tells us the priests were supposed to teach the meaning of the Bible. They were given the rituals, the law, the rules. Not just to have them, but to teach them to the people so the people would know the meaning of salvation and grace. But they had no idea. They had no idea. They thought it was just barbecue every day. So Jesus gives them a cleansed man. He gives them the meaning. And he said, and what that man is supposed to do is, after he goes through the whole ritual, he tells them, Jesus did it. Jesus did it. To show them a few years later that when Jesus goes to the cross, sheds His blood, dies, it's for us. It's for our cleansing. It's for our renewal. For our new life. So that the priests, now that they understand it, can finally teach it. Are you getting that? Yeah? But he blows it. You read it right there, right? Verse 44, 45. He just goes and tells whoever he wants. He kind of ruined it. Just kind of ruined the story. Why does he do that? I don't know. It's just disobedience. You think, oh yeah, the guy's saved. Hallelujah. But he's not obeying Jesus. And Jesus, the whole chapter, if you read Mark chapter 1, chapter 2, Jesus is trying to just get to the people. He's trying to get there. And he said all he wants to do is go from town to town to town to preach the good news, to reach the people who can't get to him. But now this guy, he just goes off, does whatever he wants, and now people can't get to Jesus, and Jesus can't get to them. They're just crowding. He can't move around, right? That's what it says. And so he has to go out to the lonely places. Sick people can't go out to the lonely places. They're stuck in bed. So he kind of ruins it for us. But it says, but they found a way to get to him. In fact, there's one time where they opened up the roof and they lowered the guy down to him. So we're going to come to the communion table, to the blood and the bread, to the blood of the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Some of you, you need to be cleansed. You need it. You don't think that. Some of you think, I don't believe that, Chris. I'm not a leper. I don't have sin that's ravaging my body. Well, that's because you live in a world that's a whole big leper colony. All of this world is racked. So you look around, I'm not as bad as that guy. Trust me. Jesus Christ, holy God, when he looks at your sinful life, he knows your heart. He sees your sin. It's just like leprosy to him. You need to be clean. You need it. Now, others of you, you know that. Chris, yes, I'm filthy. I'm vile. I'm disgusting. The things I think, the things I've done, the things I've said, the things that I do to others, the things I've done to myself, I'm filthy. Or, Chris, man, yes, what's been done to me, the abuse that's been put on me, the filth that's been put on me, I just need a shower. I need to be cleansed. You need to pray the prayer that this man prayed. Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. So you come to the cross. You come to Jesus, who will reach out and touch you and says, yes. That's where you go. And you can do it again and again. He loves you. He's done it all the way. He's already done it. The book of Luke says he healed everybody. He healed everybody. So you can come too and get your healing, your cleansing, be made whole. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah.